I'm Jessica Moyer. This is Good Morning LaLa Land, America's first live streaming daily talk show, coming to you live Monday through Friday at 9 a.m. on Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, and Twitch, also available on Apple TV and Roku.
And today is Thought Thursday. What day is it? Thought Thursday. We're going to talk about,
And we depend on you to remind us of the day.
We're going to talk about the difference between FOMO versus FREMO, the fear of missing out versus having some free time for yourself.
I love it.
Which I think I had a little bit too much, apparently.
Did you?
Come together each day to know the truth, live on spiritual principle, align with universal law, and talk to some amazing guests about their personal inspirational stories.
That's right. I'm so happy to see you guys again. Feels like it's been a while.
It has been. It was like Sunday number two yesterday. Happy Memorial Day. We hope all of you had a wonderful holiday weekend. It was so low-key here in LaLa Land. It was, the streets were quiet. It almost felt like the Christmas holiday or something.
It was
Everybody had left. Mm-hmm. It was just an opportunity to rest. It rained. We had to.
It was really, it's like everything's been just shut down in the last few weeks, right?
Except the Third Street Promenade. It was
It was?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was.
It was busy.
I guess because, everyone goes down there for the holidays.
And lots of tourists too, you know.
Oh, yeah. That is a Santa Monica thing.
Yeah.
Summer's coming.
I know.
It's intense down there.
It is intense down there. That's why I don't have any friends in the summer. Like, we're not coming to Santa Monica, Rob.
It's too much of a hassle. Well,
I took the advice of one of our past guests, you know, the good witch, master of magic herself, and she had said, you should really go hike the Hollywood Reservoir, which I had never done. Lived in LA for 12 years, and it's always been shut down. It was so beautiful. The whole hike is actually open. It had been shut down because of a rock slide a couple of years ago. And they have a bridge that goes around the reservoir. Beautiful. Sparkling water, and you can see the Hollywood sign. It was a really magical place to like manifest the next season.
Wow, super cool.
I love that. Yeah, I didn't have such a, I had the weirdest thing happen. Okay, so was it Sunday? Yes, Sunday. So Sunday I'm out running around doing some stuff and I forgot something. So I ran back in the house and I pull in kind of my driveway at the very front and I thought, well, I'll just leave it here instead of going all the way to the back because I'm just going to run in real quick and grab something. So I ran in and I don't remember what I was grabbing. And I got back in the car and I go to just kind of pull out and I'm pulling out different than I normally would. And all of a sudden I hear this little noise.
Oh, no.
And I get out of my car and I look, and my entire front bumper is off of my car with like wires going to it. It was the most random. It was so random though, you guys. And I was like, what is the universe trying to tell me?
The wall of fire.
Only you would have that response.
Wall of fire, right?
Dr. Erin, you'd only.
But it was funny because I was like, kind of like, this kind of sucks, but I was like, okay, first world problems. There's there's so much worse things that could be going on right now.
That's
so it's like,
so
you just like take a breath. Get back on principle.
Oh man, so now you have to put the car in the shop, huh?
Yeah, it's gotta go in the shop, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, well, sending our love and light to the people in the Midwest who are just, I mean, completely like attacked by tornadoes.
Right.
Last night, over 12 tornadoes just ripped through Ohio and so many homes were lost in belongings and memories, so our heart goes out to you.
Right, that puts it totally in perspective.
It does.
Like a bumper, who cares? Like,
yeah, exactly.
I mean, you know, I just think about all the other things and just even like my son's, their dog went through almost passed away this last week.
Oh my gosh.
Got bit by a spider and its entire like face got all these boils all over. It was the weirdest thing, you guys.
Really?
You should see some of the pictures. It's the poor dog was like tormented for days on end. And so it just puts things in perspective. We have to stay in gratitude every single day and just know that, you know, we're so blessed in so many ways and just sending love to all the people that lost their homes.
Totally. And it's the simple things, the simple small things are significant things. Having a house.
Right.
Being, you know, alive, being healthy.
Right, our health, for sure.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, speaking of gratitude, we are so grateful for Love Bites by Chef Val.
Yes.
Thank you so much for surprising us with these incredible chocolate handmade shoes.
Chocolate.
Aren't these so cute?
I don't even want to eat it. It's too pretty to eat.
They were a special gift at the 46th annual Daytime Emmys, including this What's Your Passion jewelry.
Wow.
It was specially designed. It has the Marvel logo on one side and memory of the 46th annual Daytime Emmys on this side. It is so cute. So we're just so grateful to continue to be a part of your community and share in your support and friendship.
So sweet.
So lovely, right?
Oh my gosh.
I know.
Mm. So today, talking about transformation, we were talking about an article actually that you sent over about FOMO.
Yeah.
Can you tell us a little bit about the article?
Basically, people are stressed. Surprise. But folks feel like they're missing out on a lot these days. So it disrupts their sleep, disrupts their sense of peace and well-being, and I think we all struggle or have struggled with that a lot in our lives, depending on sort of who you are and what your intentions mm-hmm. are for your life. But I know you and I talk about that quite a bit, Jez, right?
Absolutely. FOMO is something I struggle with severely, right? Fear of missing out. And it's not even so much that something's happening without me, but perhaps that I haven't done enough to be included. Or to be where I'm meant to be. There's a woman in the article who's referenced and said that she kept taking course after course because she felt like she had upper game continually rather than really appreciating everything she knew and where she was at and enjoying the moment.
Yes.
I can't get over that. Yeah. I recognize it so clearly, but it's like I'm handcuffed to FOMO.
Yeah. I'm the opposite. I have a fear of having too many things that I just like, I want to say no to everything.
That's me. I feel that way too. Right. I call it JOMO, the joy of missing out.
Honestly, like, oh, please don't ask me to go to that. You know,
yeah.
I'm the same.
So have you always been that way or?
I think I remember clearly in high school having total FOMO. Like if I remember a very specific Friday night, I didn't have plans and I was sitting at home and I thought my life was over as I knew it. And now I'm just completely the opposite. If I have a free evening, I am just tickled.
Yeah. Just, tickled. Yeah. I haven't heard that word for a while.
It's like, oh, freemo. Yes. So it's like fear of freedom of more time with yourself.
Yeah.
So,
oh, I love that. Yeah. That's fantastic. It's interesting because I certainly had FOMO for a long time in my life. And then I think, you know, I was blessed and fortunate enough to go to like some events that were spectacular, right? Jez goes to those events mm-hmm. all the time. You go to those events all the time. And I remember going and being like, oh, I'm at the White House, or I'm at this award show, or I'm with like all these
the
A-list celebrities.
Only Rob Black hangs out of the White House.
But the funny thing is that it was fun for like 20 or 30 minutes, and then I was like, I just kind of want to be home in bed reading a book, yeah. or writing a book, or doing something else. I just remember thinking, right. after I had so many of those experiences, you know, I sort of like lost FOMO.
Oh man, not me. The more I experience, the more I want to be out there and thrive in it, the more I feel like I have to do to like maintain that. It's in a weird way, my FOMO is almost like keeping up with the Joneses, not because I want to have those things, but I want to be in all those places.
Yeah.
With all of those people. It feeds me.
I like to be out. I just love to be with like one or two people and have like more of a like connection, like a deeper conversation. Yeah. I find that at the events, my energy is kind of spread out and I don't really ever truly connect with one person. Yeah, and so true. I don't really feel like my soul doesn't feel fed in those situations.
It's interesting you say that because I discovered I was an empath. So mm-hmm. when I'm out in like public spaces and there's a lot of like frenetic energy, I feel it
totally,
deeply and
completely.
I feel unsettled
I'm
and I feel rattled by
completely.
It. Yeah, so you know, that's gotten better and better over the years, but I would say that I still feel other people's emotions, so mm-hmm. it makes it a little bit more difficult. The other thing too is I discovered like in the beginning I was trying to go to events to network, but I found that all of the really transformative connections or contacts I made, they always happen in the most random
right.
places in the world, like
mm-hmm.
the gym, the grocery store, the airport, and it never happened at a networking event.
Totally, completely agree.
Yeah, it's really weird.
So fascinating.
But I'm still not cured. I still haven't.
But you're really good at it though, Jess.
But so. I think as long as you know that's who you are and that's what you like to do, I don't think that's fear of missing out. I think it's more for you a place of being authentic for yourself.
I agree.
Versus like a fear of missing out. You know what I mean? I think that's the distinction.
It's and you're a super connector, yeah. Jess. Like, you know, you're really good at connecting with people and connecting other people with those people. So we call that a super connector, and I think you know, you flourish in that space.
Well, for speaking sure. of that, I'd love to connect you to our very special guest this morning. Hello, ladies, back in the studio. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Wow, we're so grateful you're here with us today. We've got Sharon Blynn in the house. She's an actress and a cancer activist. Good morning, Sharon. How are you?
I'm doing well, thank you.
We're so grateful that you're with us today. So here on Good Morning Lawland, we like to know about your morning routine. How do you start your day?
Oh my goodness. Well, I definitely have a big glass of water. And I do a little stretching, and then I hit the road, depending on what I have to do. So, because I usually work out, if I do any exercise, I'm an afternoon. I'm not particularly a morning person, so I kind of get myself going, and then I'm up and at 'em, and then in the afternoon, I like to do a workout of some sort. Yeah.
Nice.
Fantastic. It's like amazing how some of the simple things are so important, right? Like a drink of water
right?
like in the morning.
Yes.
I realize that you're dehydrated overnight.
It's very energizing.
Take some pointers. Water would be good in the morning.
I'm sure Dr. Nicola has some pointers for us. Good morning. How are you?
Good morning. Very well. Grateful to be here.
Well, we are grateful you're here with us. Tell us a little bit about how you start your day and what your morning routine is.
Well, my first thought is gratitude. Thank you for today. Thank you for the lessons that will surely come. Thank you for the blessings. Thank you for my body. Thank you for all of the things that will serve me in this beautiful life and serve my soul's evolution. And then I have water.
In that order.
Yes.
Love that.
I love that.
Gotta feed the body, gotta feed the soul.
Well, looking forward to hearing all your stories. Beautiful dress, by the way. So gorgeous.
Thank you.
Right?
Absolutely.
So coming to Transformation Tuesday also, we talk a lot about subconscious mind, and it's fascinating, you know. They say that by the time you're 35 years old, that 95%+ of your life is ran by the subconscious.
Wow.
And that any emotion that you're experiencing is from the past. It's from past programming. So we actually have to have our thinking and our thoughts have to be stronger than our emotion. And I remember years back in my 20s being like, I had to go on. My emotions ruled my life. It's like, well, if I feel like it, then I'll do it. If I don't feel like it, I don't do it. But we have to know that a lot of those feelings, you have to distinguish between what is actual intuition versus what is just programming that's having you stay comfortable or whatever it is, right?
That's fantastic.
So how do you guys do that?
Oh, man. I'd say that through my like childhood to my early adult teen, I did the opposite of that. If I felt like if I didn't feel like doing something, I would force myself to
do
it. It was very self-punitive, I suppose.
Interesting.
So I was all about discipline, and I'm still about discipline, but it's different now because it's really revolves around bliss. I call it bliss.
I love that.
So yeah, it's a good point, Erin. I don't know exactly how the shift happened. I think I basically got fed up and sick and tired of being sick and tired. Mm-hmm. And I was like, this isn't working for me.
Well, I was hoping you two would tell me. I'm really struggling in this whole transformation and self-awakening and figuring who the heck you are at any age, right? That has been such a struggle for me, whether it's the programming or my intuition. And it's like, I'm stuck in between both worlds. I don't know. It's like, I'm constantly torn by that. I wake up at night and I'm panicking. I'm overthinking things. I don't know where I'm coming from or why I'm freaking out for no reason, but I can't seem to figure that out.
Yeah.
Interesting.
One of the things that I think cured me partially of that very early on was just the realization of my own mortality. I just had a very deep sense of how short my life would be, whether it was by my own hands,
right.
Suicidal, or whether it was some other way. I think that put me in touch with the truth, which is that for me, peace is priceless. Mm-hmm. So once I started really optimizing for peace, everything else sort of followed from there,
right?
So when you optimize for peace, all of a sudden, you don't want to do anything that's not very peaceful. You don't want to do anything that's very
How do you optimize for your own peace without taking responsibility for the peace of your mother, your sister, your lover, whatever it is?
Yeah, I think you spend time alone, Jez. Yeah. You know, the best thing you can do is spend time alone and begin to simply practice letting thoughts go and just breathing and experiencing the joy and the peace and the bliss that comes from simply breathing and not thinking. That is probably as helpful as anything.
Epigenetics is doing some great research on all this, and they're finding that as you get into, and we're like responsible for, if we're in any kind of stress level whatsoever, it actually hurts ourselves. Yeah. And when you get clear of that, when you understand it turns off, like it damages your genes. Literally, it decreases and turns on things like that can happen like cancer or whatever. Yeah. So when you get clear and you understand the level of what stress does to the body, you get that you cannot afford to not be in peace.
It's true.
You cannot, and it will turn on all. We can heal miraculously. They're having more and more studies around miraculous healings when you turn off stress, when you turn into that bliss discipline and really reprogram. And it's habits. We either can habitually get stressed out or can habitually get into joy. And when we get determined and committed to being in peace, we literally watch our lives transform in front of us. And stress is the number one cause of everything.
Absolutely,
It's like, how much do you love yourself? I had to ask myself, like, if I love myself, it isn't good for me to stress about my son. The best thing I can do is actually stress about anyone or my mom or this or whatever. That's actually hurting them because it's informing the subjective mind and informing the universal mind. And it's resisting what is, and it's actually persisting that to happen.
I just love that you say that because emotion is contagious, right? We know emotion is contagious as anything. And that actually, even if you have a friend, let's say, who's going through a divorce or a breakup, you're 50% more likely to have it or experience a divorce and breakup in the next 3 years as a result of that.
Right.
And so if you really want to help anybody else in your life, the greatest thing you could possibly do is find peace and find happiness within yourself.
No question about it.
Yeah. But you do have to, I think, have faith in peace and have faith in happiness that it's going to lead you to a more effective, efficient, productive, and profitable life in all areas. Otherwise, you start to freak out and you're like, oh my gosh, if I find peace, what am I gonna do about money?
Right.
You know.
And they found that even like less than 2% of the population actually is born with any kind of predetermined disease. That it is all done through turning on and off the genes. And how is that done? That's done through the environment. How is our environment? It's by the choices that we make and the environment that we choose to put ourselves in.
Yeah.
And so it's all up to us. It's all in the mind. It is a mental game here.
And it's just practice. I mean, I think we make it so difficult often because we try to do 99 things at the same time. But if you just choose one healthy habit and stick to that one habit, it will take you like 90% of the way, right?
Yeah. Even if you haven't mastered it, trying is enough. I'm certainly not perfect at it at all. So if you find yourself freaking out, you're not crazy. It's a totally normal experience, and you just have to continue to persist and work towards that piece.
100%.
Every step counts.
Yeah, one day it just becomes automatic. It just clicks.
Yeah, I look forward to that.
I love it so funny. I just remember that thinking like, well, one day I'll be happy or peaceful when, you know, it's like, it just never, it just can't be contingent upon anything.
Exactly.
It can happen right here.
That's right, exactly. You always assume that it's just one more experience, one more relationship. Mm-hmm. The mind convinces you of that. It feels so real.
I know.
And then you get into the next one, you're like, oh, that was kind of like the last one. You get into another one, oh, that was kind of like the last one. It'll be the next one though, but it never ends.
I'm just obsessed with the resistance. Like, what are you resisting in your life? And like, where is that? And that is the source of the suffering.
Mm.
I mean, what are we resisting?
Yeah.
If there's any resistance whatsoever, that is all in mind, and that is what's causing the stress.
I do love that. I agree with you. I think that happiness and peace and love ultimately is non-resistance, isn't it? It doesn't mean being a doormat, but it does mean not being full of resistance.
Yeah, so great.
Awesome. Hmm.
Well, let's take a break. When we come back, we're going to talk to our extraordinary guests about how they have transformed their lives. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Live from the Pasadena Civic Auditorium, it's the 46th Annual Daytime Emmy Awards, celebrating the best in daytime. So get ready for some major excitement.
Congratulations, by the way, on being honored tonight for the Lifetime Achievement Award. How does that feel?
Well, apparently, this is the first time they do it for someone in the food world. So, it's pretty exciting.
It's because of you I know how to poach an egg. Hi, Soledad! You know, we were just talking about how this jewelry can make us feel royal. How are you feeling
tonight?
Thank you.
Incredibly royal and a little teeny bit itchy.
So, 16 years ago, is there anything you wish you would have known then that you know now?
That's a great question. I think what I've learned is nobody knows what they're doing.
So elegant and also fierce. I always say hashtag fashion speaks.
I like that. What is this saying to you? What is it speaking for?
For me, it's speaking that you can be truly feminine and stand in your divine power.
Wow, I love that.
What a fashion moment!
And we are welcoming the team behind Disney Junior's Vampirina. Congratulations on your wish!
This program has continued for decades to change the world. Congratulations! Yes, go have fun! Celebrate! I'm so excited to see you just blossom. Celebrate and honor the hard work and talent of those who bring your favorite daytime programs to life. It's been an honor to join you. I'm Jez Moyet.
It's an honor to be with you on Connect TV at the 46th Annual Daytime Emmy Awards here in Pasadena. I'm so excited to welcome the nominees, the presenters, the special performers, and the hardest working talent in daytime television. General Hospital Emmy nominee Lisa, hi, congratulations.
Hello,
Anthony Rodriguez, Emmy nominee tonight. It's so incredible to honor your friends and your family, the people that make your career a success. Vincent DePaul is such a man about Hollywood. He's always popping in. You never know where you're going to see him next. Thank you for sharing this spot.
I mean, daytime people are the best in the world, and I could not share it with anyone more beautiful than you. So there you go.
I appreciate it.
No. Carolyn Hennessy here in the winner's circle with the beautiful Jeslyn Moye, who took over for me, and I think is probably stealing my crown next year, maybe. And we're just kind of discussing the red carpet or the Friday night.
Thank you for sharing your crown with me. It was such an incredible honor to cover the red carpet for the 46th Annual Creative Arts Emmys and to step in for you tonight.
It's fun.
What a moment to celebrate daytime television and that we are welcomed and representing this family is truly humbling, and I am forever grateful for this experience.
Oh, please. My pleasure.
Honestly.
Your show, La La Land, which I was on and which I loved.
Thank you.
The questions you asked were so interesting for me and for all the guests that day. Your show has a lot of heart.
We really do. We really do. There is a positive shift happening in Hollywood, and that is heart. I do think so. I do. I do, Carolyn. I believe we are on the rise, and we are on the rise together.
Welcome back to Good Morning, LaLa. On Transformation Tuesday, there's nothing better than transforming through conscious conversations. And Dr. NICOLA SISO is in from Aspen.
Yes.
She has a platform called Aspen Talks Health. And just thank you so much for being here and bringing your conscious conversation to the world.
Thank you.
We love your dress. Oh my gosh, so gorgeous.
Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you for all that you're doing on the show. It's really important work.
Tell us a little bit about your journey to beginning that platform.
Sure. So I realized that my mission was to do my best at shifting humanity towards a more compassionate way of living. Mm-hmm. And I've learned that nutrition is a huge part of that. What we eat is so important, both to our own health, to the environment's health, and the animal well-being. Mm-hmm. What we're doing in livestock production is torturous. Yeah. It's horrible. And then I had a personal journey with type 1 diabetes. I got diagnosed at 29 years old, which this kind you should get at 4. So it made no sense, but the doctor sent me home and said, you know, it's just genetic, here's your meds, good luck. And that's not the case. The more I explored, there are so many things that cause type 1 diabetes. Mm-hmm. Antibiotics, ruining your gut health, wheat and casein, milk, gliadin and wheat and casein and milk, both are proteins that will attach to your pancreas cells, mm-hmm. tag them as antigens, and then your immune system goes in and destroys your own cells that produce insulin. Mm-hmm. So there's also adverse childhood experiences.
Right. You know, so the point is that they say that only 1-2% of the population actually is born with type 1 diabetes, mm-hmm. that it's actually an environmentally, can be turned on, the genes can actually be turned on through environment, but it really comes down to consciousness, because our stress comes down to consciousness, okay. and how what we choose to put in our bodies, what the culture has created in our water and so on and so forth.
So true.
So this is, I believe, it's a blessing and a curse, because it's become your mission, right?
Absolutely. It's absolutely a blessing. And that's part of my show's mission is to share that a disease is a blessing. And if you can, as soon as you can see it as that, it's your body talking to you. It's telling you that you're doing something wrong.
So what was your body saying, if you don't mind me asking? What were some of the symptoms and the signs you felt physically and mentally that you were unwell, that this was not normal?
Sure, the first sign is exhaustion. I was so tired all day long. And then the second symptom, when I was getting close to really being diagnosed, was a thirst. I could have drank a gallon of water, gone to the restroom every 10 minutes, and still extremely thirsty. Mm. And the last symptom was my eyesight went out. It got very blurry. I was living in New York, and I couldn't read the numbers of the street signs right below the street sign.
Whoa.
And I was like, okay, this is not right. So I went to the doctor, and they showed my blood sugars were at 560-something. And a normal range is between 90 and 120.
Wow.
So I was way off. Mm-hmm. I was going into a coma.
So what was the first thing you did to kind of reverse that for yourself?
Sure, so
lifestyle factors besides medication.
Right. I learned quickly that I need to learn about nutrition more. So I ended up getting a PhD in holistic nutrition. And I learned, actually, that a high-fat diet is a cause of insulin resistance. So you end up having to produce more insulin in order to compensate for any sugars that come in. I need to go into more detail, but so that's one thing. So I lowered my fat, and then I was able to have fruits without my sugars spiking,
mm-hmm.
which was important to learn. Also about the wheat and the milk, I was on wheat and dairy before, and so those things needed to come out of my diet right away. Things like that.
What about the stress level? We know that stress majorly plays into turning on the genes.
Yeah, absolutely. Exploring childhood experiences, mm-hmm. and doing a lot of work around that was important, and how they were triggering me to respond in ways that's not how I wanted to show up. Also, starting my day, like I was just saying before, with being happy with myself. Mm. How many women look in the mirror and they point out the one thing they're not happy with?
Guilty.
Right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Instead, like, shift. Look at the parts that you love and say thank you for that part. Mm-hmm. You know, as we put so much attention to, like, right? You know?
It's
all I see. This is one little section. It's ridiculous.
It's like, ridiculous, right?
You know, but self-love is so important. If you can love yourself, then you can love others. You show up so nicely for the rest of the day, and your cells feel it.
Right.
Also,
no, just how did you? Was there anything specific that you did in order to like reduce your stress and love yourself better? Was it just a commitment and a decision you made, or were there specific tools and techniques that you practiced?
So the specific tools was quickly switching. So when I did look in the mirror and I pointed out the one thing, I said, no, what do I love about my body? Mm-hmm. So quickly switching the thoughts. And also being more mindful about when I'm eating, being grateful for the food, and taking the time to really honor my body when it says it's full. And then if I overeat or I overindulge or I go for the muffin when I know I shouldn't or something like that, instead of bashing myself afterwards, which was my specialty, I would just say, you know what, that was what I needed. My soul needed that. Mm-hmm. And just and then I'll make wiser choices next time. And then next time I think, okay, how do I want to feel after I eat this?
So interesting. Right. I mean, we wonder if the muffin's worse for us or the guilt
totally.
That goes with the muffin, right?
Right. Because
it's yeah. ridiculous.
Because right? you're telling your body what I just ate was poison.
Right? And so it is. Yeah. Right?
And so it is.
So take us from when you figured out you were diabetic to creating the platform that you have.
Yeah, quite a journey. The show actually has been healing me. So my goal was to, I was doing this anyway at home. I was reading articles, watching webinars, learning from all these wonderful experts. And then it's just for me. But I was like, why don't I share this with the world? So I started interviewing experts in all health and healing modalities. I love alternative healing modalities. Yeah. That's my favorite. But also nutrition, parenting, relationships. I love the gut-brain health. Mm-hmm.
So
that access, fascinating. Mm-hmm. I mean, the antibiotics use and what we're doing to our gut is those produce more serotonin and dopamine. Mm-hmm. These are your happy motivation drugs.
There's more biochemistry than our cells in our body. Like, it's amazing.
It is amazing.
Right? Yeah.
What these little bacteria are doing, and we are sterilizing everything, including our insides.
Mm-hmm.
Especially with the types of food that we choose as well, because antibiotics are put into the food system, in the livestock production as well.
So what do we do? I mean, should we just give up? I'm depressed.
It's a lot, right?
It is daunting.
No, it is daunting, you're right.
It is daunting. I mean, what are some simple steps that we and our viewers can implement in our daily lives just to make small but meaningful progress?
Absolutely. First step, shop at your farmer's market. Buy all local organic sourced foods that are picked the day before, so they're ripe, they're fresh, they're not being trucked from across the world or shipped,
right?
Yeah, because if they cross, it's just they're being plucked way before they're even ripe. They're not even getting all the nutrients out of the ground. And if it's not organic, they're really not getting the nutrients.
Right.
Biodynamic farming is absolutely the ultimate ideal source, and that's good again for yourself, for your environment, for the animals. It's so important. Buy from your farmer's market.
I love that Sunday farmer's
market. Yeah,
I'm down. Yeah. Wednesdays in Santa Monica. Yeah. It's berries. June, those strawberries are unreal.
Oh, the strawberries. Oh my goodness.
Well, and that's always been something that's been very important to me too, is eat fruits and vegetables that are of this season.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Right, because nature actually designed it that way. Mm-hmm. So in autumn, you'll see a lot of orangey colors. And orange has loaded with beta carotene. And beta carotene stimulates your immune system, which prepares you for winter, so you don't get sick. Mm-hmm. Nature's smart.
Mm-hmm. It's interesting how many problems we create because we think we're smarter or can outsmart nature itself, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's kind of wild to me.
So tell them what your platform is exactly, because not everybody knows what it is.
Sure. Right now it's called Aspen Talks Health, which I may be rebranding because I'm moving to LA, which
she's
I'm very excited
it.
About.
Should she name it Manhattan Talks or Venice Talks? Which one should
right?
she name it?
I know. I might end up with Dr. Nicola, the Dr. Nicola Show, but we'll see. But so the platform is all about interviewing experts, and so we learn together what we can do, and they usually share their journey. Most people have their own journey that led them, again, disease is a blessing, right? It leads them to researching more and finding out what the solutions are.
I love it.
Yeah.
So important.
Well, thank you for doing all that work for us.
Thank
we
you.
We truly appreciate it. Tell everyone where they can find and follow your journey.
Absolutely. AspenTalksHealth.com. AspenTalks, TALKS.com and AspenTalksHealth.com, and that's it. Yeah, or on Facebook, on YouTube is my main channel.
And Instagram at AspenTalks.
Sure.
Fantastic.
Stay tuned.
We'll
be back with more in the morning, Holland.
We'll be right back.
first live streaming daily talk show coming to you live Monday through Friday at 9 a.m. All of these interviews are available as a podcast on iTunes, and the whole show can be seen on EverTalk TV, now available on Apple TV.
This is my first TV experience. I'm so happy I did it with you.
Thank you guys so much for watching. You can always find these videos and binge them on EverTalk TV. Thanks for coming. Bye.
Live from Los Angeles, welcome back to Good Morning La Land. We are so honored to welcome SHARON BLYNN to the show. She is a cancer survivor, an activist, and an incredible actress. Thank you for being with us
today. Thank you. Happy to be here.
Your journey of personal transformation is so incredibly inspiring. Would you mind sharing it with us?
Sure. Gosh, where to begin? Well, I had ovarian cancer. I was diagnosed at age 28 and came completely out of nowhere, quote unquote, as you guys would probably call it. Mm-hmm. I went through down that path and got several appointments later, figured out I had ovarian cancer. There's no test. So ultimately I had to have surgery, and then they look at it under the microscope and they give you the diagnosis. And then that's when all my research began, and I didn't even know really much about ovarian cancer. It's not really talked about so much. But then part of the effects, of course, of going through treatment include hair loss, and that was one of the initial things after losing part of my ovary and learning what does that mean for a woman, a 28-year-old woman, and then losing my hair, and I had really long hair, and it was part of my sort of hippie jazz chick trademark look, and I was like, okay, who am I without my hair? And then feeling a little troubled and annoyed that I even had to think about that question while I'm fighting for my life. And so I just, along the way, I met women who had a harder time with losing hair or even than losing breasts or reproductive organs or having cancer. So I just thought, okay, that's such a weird out of balance thing with just the hair. Why is that so powerful? Mm-hmm. And then I realized the power of images to transform mm-hmm. how we see ourselves, because I didn't see myself out there, like in TV and movies and things in general, but also specifically when they're portraying someone going through cancer who's always a lot older than me, and also wearing a scarf that didn't fit very well and gray and knocking on heaven's door kind of look. And I didn't look that way or feel that way. And I just felt like, okay, why is everything around me making me feel worse about myself?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So that was when the little spark started of, you know, I'd like to do something to put other images out there that reflect me and the greater us, that can be a positive reference and sort of a visual societal hug
so
that we need so much.
Mm. Hair is a big identity for a lot of women, and it's a huge identity.
Yes.
It's a facet. Yes. Like, it's
but men have the option to shave. You know, when certain very famous people started doing it, sort of, you know, but women weren't given the option of, oh, well, if you're starting to lose your hair for whatever reason,
right,
just shave it off.
Well,
you know?
If you have a beautiful head, you know, it's like
I got a good head of my
shelf. That's right. I do think it is interesting to take it and spin it and say, this is, you know, this is not only just for cancer, but also just an image that could be
in general
in itself.
In
right?
sickness and in health, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Tell us about Bald is Beautiful and what your mission is.
Mm-hmm. Well, when I started it, I had read stories from other people that kind of helped me. And so I thought, well, why would my voice not be helpful for someone else? And I was just learning about this worldwide interwebs thing.
A crazy thing out there.
Analog
Internet
girl
thing.
In the digital world. So it was like,
people
okay.
People are using that thing.
They're really, this is 2000. This is before social media. This mm-hmm. is, you know, before any of that really was so much more ubiquitous than it is now. So I just thought, okay, I thought about a book, but then there's a faster way. I can just kind of write some of the things of my story and just put it out there on the web. And a friend of mine helped me build this very basic, you know, simple website to share certain stories about what I went through emotionally, but also things like for caregivers and how they can sort of participate and not feel helpless. Everybody kind of feels helpless in the journey, and they're all along with us. My sister helped, you know, she decorated my hospital rooms to make them more joyful and upbeat, mm-hmm. and had pictures like along the bedside, so when I would be laying in bed, I could just turn my head and see faces of people who love me mm-hmm. next to me. We're twins, so that was also like, mm-hmm. yeah, very interesting journey too. Identical twins, and we found out we're identical because of my cancer. We took a genetic test. We were told we were fraternal our whole lives.
Oh, wow.
We don't have the BRCA1 and 2 gene, but oh, by the way, you're identical. So that was like.
Wow.
So we were just talking in the last interview that how, you know, disease is a blessing in weird different ways, right?
Yes.
Yes.
So for you, how do you view your cancer now?
It's I kind of immediately saw it as an opportunity to learn. Even visual exercises I was going to give myself during chemo. Like first I had was a carboplatin and Taxol with us. So it was like Captain Carboplatin and the Taxol Army are going in to kill the cancer. And I was like, but that's like a lot of anger and violence inside my body. Mm-hmm. So then I decided Indiana Jones. We're going to excavate these tumors and these things, and we're going to examine them. And what can we learn from them? It's sort of this, I'm a nerd too, so like, okay, what am I going to learn about myself? And I also did a lot of research about complementary therapies. I worked with a medical intuitive. Mm-hmm. That work actually continued for about 10 years.
Oh, wow.
And did some Chinese herbs and acupuncture and meditation. Learned about all this stuff that I knew about, but didn't really actively. It sort of was there, but now it's like front activation in my mind and my life.
So how did this fuel you creatively in your journey as an actress?
I wasn't an actor before that. Mm. So it was the beginning because I said, okay, well, how do I get the image out there? And that's, you know, TV, movies, print, whatever. Mm-hmm. My sister's an actor. She's been doing it for a long time and mostly stage and avant-garde, independent, really quirky stuff that is insane and powerful and amazing. And she actually gave me my first gig. We did a performance called Off the Muff, an ensemble of women doing first-person autobiographical. And I was going through treatment at the time, and I was doing a lot of journaling about my ovaries, letters to my ovaries, farewell letters to my ovaries.
I love that.
And things like that. So that was the first, my first entree. I white-knuckled it through the whole.
I love that. I love that you call it an activist.
Activist,
which is, I believe, the only reason to really be in Hollywood. Because whether you're just expanding consciousness and having somebody see a new perspective of a complete, you know, dark character, or whether you're bringing light through bringing awareness and consciousness, for me, it's all.
Yes, that's the fuel behind what I do is my activism. So I just said, well, that's, I'm not just an actor, and I never acted before, so that's, I'm an activist.
Well, it clearly fueled you well into the Marvel universe. Oh my God. Can we talk about that for a second? What has that journey been like for you?
That's just, I can't even, on every level. Professionally, I'm also a Marvel fan, geek, nerd, since childhood, read comic books and cartoons, like, so all that. So personally, professionally, and for Bald is Beautiful, because the kind of platform like being and talking to you lovely, wonderful people and your viewers, being able to share that message, that's the whole reason I got involved with doing what I'm doing. So it's extraordinary on every possible level. And, you know, I got to be married to Ben Mendelsohn, which is
pretty good.
Pretty cool.
Pretty cool.
That's awesome.
And work with Brie Larson and all that is amazing.
So if you had, I'm sure you've answered this question a million times, but indulge me, please, for a moment. If you had a superpower, what would it be?
My superpower is empathy.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
And I have thought about that a lot. My religion is compassion, and my superpower is empathy. Mm-hmm. Because I feel like if we do everything from a sense of self-love and care and compassion, every act that we do, if that's where it's centered and fueled from, then we will be all right.
Mm-hmm. Wow, it's profound. Mm-hmm. Would you have given that same answer before the disease, before all the modalities you used and before acting?
Probably in a different context. I was in the music business, and I was the whole fuel behind what I was doing with that was bringing great art to the world to because art is such a powerful tool to bring people together, to unite and inspire people. And I was in the music business, in the jazz biz in New York City. Mm-hmm. And that was the reason I was doing that too, just love of music and wanting to bring that kind of thing to other people. It's really kind of like, I've always been a behind the scenes person doing that, and now I'm just doing it like kind of the inverted version of that, being in front of the camera, which is, if you would have told me that 10 years ago, that part of would have been no way. Right. Staying bald and acting, no way.
So what do you think is the biggest message for your activism?
Well, the Bald is Beautiful motto is always smile from the inside out. So that's, no matter what is going on the outside, what we're feeling inside is what radiates the world. All the layers that we are told that we have to put on and to look and conform to certain ideas of standards of what's attractive and beautiful and whole, underneath it all, we can't cover up what's going on inside. And that's what people will read no matter what. Always smile from the inside out.
Thank you for that.
I love
sharing your time and light. Please tell everyone how they can follow your journey and get involved with Bald.
Of course, baldisbeautiful.org is my website, .org. And on Instagram, I'm at bald.is.beautiful. Mm-hmm.
Fantastic.
And there's a Facebook blog, Bald is Beautiful blog on Facebook.
I love that. Oh. So tell us a little bit more about how you actually healed. We had the Gores on, Kelly Gores for Heal, and a bunch of people on the documentary, and having spontaneous remission and cancer. How did you actually heal?
Well, it wasn't spontaneous.
There was like 9 factors that they found that, you know, of course, we believe as a doctor divinity, I believe that going to doctors is good and doing all the other
I believe stuff both. You know, my sister actually went through a thyroid thing and she did all non-traditional, quote unquote, healing modalities. And so I was always interested in it and believe that it works. It's just everything I read, nothing was specific to ovarian cancer. So I wanted to do, you know, truly holistic. Western is not bad, evil Western medicine either. Mm-hmm. So combining both, and I saw a Chinese medical healer who had an MD as well. And her, she molded the program to support my immune system. So if I'm gonna go through chemo, which attacks the immune system, ironically, support kidney, liver, and other things that get toxins out of the body. So let the chemo in there to do what it's gonna do, and then get it out of the body faster. So I did Chinese herbs and acupuncture. I did yoga and meditation. Mm-hmm. I did laugh therapy, which for me was just renting funny movies, doing anything funny.
Yes.
You know, and visualization exercises and learning to work out. I'd never worked out. I mean, in my music business days, I was doing 18, 20 hour days, you know.
Workout in and of itself.
Plowing through, but I was having a great time. I was in the jazz mecca, New York City, working with my heroes in the jazz clubs every night till 5 or 6 o'clock in the morning. It was great.
Yeah.
It just wasn't really taking care of myself too much. So kind of like I said, it was always in there, just now activating it more front of my activation of my mind and my body and spirit and all that.
Did your experience, I would imagine, did it make you question the meaning of life and your purpose in life? And did it help you help inform?
It definitely, not question, but maybe inform or shift, like it was like a major detour. Like this, I hate to use words that sound maybe new agey to people, but like it was a calling. Like I felt really compelled to do this bald, this beautiful thing. And I didn't have any idea what that was gonna look like. Mm-hmm. And you know, I had some photos taken and had a mission statement, slapped that on the back of a headshot and kind of like, here we go. You know, I just didn't want
to
have.
So new agey to be like, as a calling. Oh gosh, that put cancer in her calling. How could she? That's hilarious.
Well, because you know, sometimes people, cancer was the best thing that ever happened to me, and it sounds weird to say that, but it changed my life and so much more for the better. And I feel like also, even if I was on the path to, you know, leaving this rented spacesuit on this spinning space ball called Earth, I wanted to choose how I was gonna move through it and out of this body. Like, okay, I can't control what's happening inside. I can control how I experience it and what I do with it while I'm here. Mm-hmm. So that was sort of the empowering thing about it too, is learning to do things that, you know, just like lean into the fear and just move past it and not let it create walls and boundaries for myself.
Beautiful, so inspiring.
Definitely a pattern interrupt, that's for sure, right?
To say the least.
I love that. Well, we're just honored to have you here. I think it's really important knowing that bald is beautiful, that you get to have whatever expression that is. And if I had a head like yours, I would just shave.
Well, it's sort of about having fun no matter what. If you're going to wear hats and scarves and wigs, like treat yourself like your own human Barbie doll and have fun. You can't cover up feeling not beautiful and ashamed. So that's why I'm saying what's underneath no matter what. So have a sense of fun and adventure with it.
I love that.
Keep smiling from the inside. Stay tuned. We'll be back with more on Good Morning LaLa.
That was the curveball. Unintentional curveball.
That was the rush.
You scared me.
I was like, okay.
3, 2, 1.
Wow.
Good design.
Okay.
Now
show
the camera.
Up to you to choose the winner. Is it Annie? Is it Haley? from Los Angeles. Welcome back to Good Morning LaLa Land on this hashtag Transformation Tuesday. We're so excited to have a master of transformation. Andrea Ward is in the house. She is an incredible image consultant and stylist. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
Okay, so tell us a little bit about your journey. We know you're a good friend of Danny.
Yes.
Danny Rojo, he referred you over. We've seen you on the Steve Harvey Show. What's your life like here in LaLa Land?
My life is just, it's amazing. I mean, I'm living my dreams out.
What are your dreams?
My dreams are right now is being a celebrity stylist and designer, working with executives, film directors, actresses.
But how did you get there? Because that's a dream for so many people, right? They want to style the stars on the red carpet. That takes a lot of work and that takes a lot of talent and drive. What was your journey to that?
Well, my journey before I became a fashion stylist or designer. So I started out from an abusive relationship. I was 23, I just finished college. And then at that time I was kind of homeless, so I didn't really have anything to kind of land my feet on. And so I personally didn't like the person I was becoming. You know, I didn't want to be a disappointment to my family, and especially for the next generation to come. So what I did was I studied, I did research online. I didn't know how to design or sew. I didn't go to school for fashion. And so I learned from YouTube and I practiced every day. And within a month, I had a whole collection of designer wear. And before I knew it, Mercedes-Benz flew me out to LA for my first show for LA Fashion Week.
How incredible is that?
What does fashion represent for you?
Fashion represents for me, it is pretty much self-expression, a statement. So my cause is against domestic violence. So I use fashion platforms to spread awareness and to protest against abuse on women and children. And not only that, so since then I've dedicated my life to the cause. You know, I actually want to be the best example to young women and even children that want to aspire and pursue their dreams. I want to show that there is endless possibilities after the storm is what I call it.
Yeah, it's interesting, you know, coming from understanding the soul and understand what's going on, it's hard to say because it's like, yes, there's definitely victims of domestic violence. And there's also like the consciousness that pulls in, you know, when we don't love ourselves, when we think love hurts and stuff like, we'll keep drawing in the abuser or the predator because there's something that needs to be held, you know, healed at a soul level. For you, getting out of that, you know, relationship, that abusive relationship, what did you have to do? What kind of work did you have to do to kind of claim that self-love and claim that self-expression?
Well, first things first, I had to start with my mindset. It's all about, you know, your perspective and different views on the world and views on yourself as well too. So what I started doing, I started like reading inspirational books, I started watching inspirational videos, I started, and I'm sort of religious, I started praying more too. Mm-hmm. And if I didn't like something about myself, I would change it. You know, I went from 340 to 170 in a short period of time, and I didn't like where I was living. It was a lot of negativity that I was surrounded by constantly. So I decided to move to LA. I decided to occupy my time. And the more I found myself occupying my time, I actually found my purpose. And the more I can help others and inspire people, the more it inspires me to be a better person and to do more. Mm-hmm. So the more I can do in this world, the more lives I can actually change. Right.
Fantastic. Are there any spiritual or inspirational teachers or authors or people in the world that you would recommend that you used to listen to or read?
Lisa Nichols. Mm. Lisa Nichols and I share a very similar story.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So important. I think it's interesting, you know, in LaLa Land, I think people see in the glitz and glamour that it's just like fashion, like it's just some mm-hmm. superficial thing. And it's been so interesting to dive deeper into the, you know, stories and people's personal journeys and realizing that, you know, majority of our guests have faith. Majority of our guests have had some big obstacle and have had to dig deep and do their inner work. And it comes out in the different expressions, whether it be in fashion or whether it be in their coaching or whether it be whatever it is. I feel like there's a core desire just to heal ourselves and to make a difference in the world. So thank you so much for all of your work. So tell us about how that translates in helping people. So give some hicks and tricks of being fully expressed in our fashion.
So I guess my last show was LA Fashion Week with Art Hearts. So what I did was I transpired my whole collection. I called it Redemption, Life
that.
After the Storm. It was very glitz, glamorous. It was very free, very loosely. It had a lot of color pops too. And a lot of my fans are like kind of international just because of the shows that I do. And a lot of girls reach out to me. So with showcasing on these fashion platforms and manipulating them to help these causes, it's opened a lot of windows for me. So right now I'm actually working with the US military for veterans that are victims of abuse.
Wow, super cool.
And what are you doing with them? Are you creating styles, designs?
Actually, it's gonna be a lot more than that this time. I'm actually developing a program, a mentoring program, to get more celebrities to be involved that have been in those same shoes. Not just domestic violence, but victims of rape or molestation. You know, it's so many people in this world that actually need my help. And the more I can just reach out, and the more I can express myself, and the more I can share my story, the more, you know, other companies and other organizations are reaching back out to me so that I can connect the pieces. And so that way we can place programs everywhere in the United States, in schools, in colleges, make it part of a curriculum to spread awareness. So that way they know the indications of domestic violence or anything of that nature. Because I feel like our youth now and the next generations are not gonna know until someone actually steps up and takes a step as a leader. Mm. So in this journey right now, I'm leading.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
The world needs your best you. It really does. We're grateful to be a part of that journey.
We sure are.
So tell people where they can find and follow you.
Everyone can follow me on AndreaWardOfficial.com. Social media is Andrea Ward Fashion Stylist.
Nice. Thank you so much. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Thank you.
Transformation here on Transformation Tuesday. Welcome back to Good Morning LaLa Land, live from Los Angeles. Question I have for all these brilliant, beautiful guests is, if there's one tip or trick you'd offer our viewers for transforming their lives from the inside out, what would that one tip be?
Definitely self-love. Yeah. I think starting there, the more loving you can be with yourself, and the more you'll have the willpower and the strength to do what is right. But it starts with first honoring yourself and being kind to yourself.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
I'll probably do a variation on that. But with the Baldur's Beautiful motto being always smile from the inside out. And I guess I would also say the extra step, like what you were saying, is that you can start from the inside, and that's being of service and listening, and then moving from that space of really taking care of oneself. And then that just mm-hmm. is a ripple effect. Out to the world.
Fantastic. Thank you.
So I would say is inspiration. In order for you to change or to overcome certain obstacles in your life, you have to find something that truly inspires you and truly puts passion in your heart.
Well, you all truly inspire me. We are Good Morning LaLa Land, America's first live streaming daily talk show, coming to you live Monday through Friday at 9 a.m. All of these interviews are available as a podcast on iTunes, and the whole show is streaming on EverTalk TV, available on Apple TV and Roku.
That's right. We're waking up the world together, you guys. Please like, share, follow all these amazing, extraordinary people, and have a great divine day.
It's going to be a good morning, LaLa Land.